Okay, thank you. So, Taral, if I can ask you, how do you avoid that lateral bump that Tanvi talked about?
So the only key to avoiding that lateral bump is to translate it medially, the distal fragment, to translate medially. Now, when you translate medially, the only issue is the medial hinge gets broken. So Tanvi, the entire stability of the modified French osteotomy, it is on intact medial hinge, which you have to preserve. And I'm very happy that in addition to two screws and wire, in most of the cases, you've added a K-wire.
Keval.
So that K-wire gave the rotational stability, which is most of the time lacking in a modified French osteotomy. So what I
Right.
would suggest is you've done good work, but if you still want to one up your result and want to give a better result to patient, complete the osteotomy, translate it and fix it simply with two cross K wires. And
Yeah.
don't use screws and TBW wire. Another advantage of doing that would be that you require a second surgery to remove the screw and TBW. And I know as a resident, I have removed these screws and TBW wires, and it's hell of a difficult job. So you can use cross KFS and remove the wires after 6 weeks or so.
If I may add, if there is an older patient, like he showed some patients who are more than 10 years old, I will always use a recon plate and plate the lateral column for the stability, because ultimately you are doing a deformity correction and I don't want to depend on K wires to hold that. I would rather do an implant removal later in older children.
So I think, Sandeep, if I may add, I think if you want to avoid bump on medial side, the best thing you can do is you can do a dome osteotomy, which inherently has angulation and translation in single cow movement.
Yeah,
And
but
the way you want an older kid plate and younger kid, you can just put K wires.
yeah,
And
but
you can use cross K wires because you have already dissected the ulnar nerve there.
yeah, but as she has mentioned, the complexity of osteotomy as it goes on increasing, the complication rate also increases.
Agreed,
So the
agreed. You need
simplest
some.
one is, yeah. So I think Rajiv, are you ready?
Yeah, I'm ready. I'm ready.
Yeah,
But I just want to compliment Tanvi on something that a lot of people don't get this. Suppose there is 20-degree varus, they correct 20 degrees. But actually, the amount of correction is amount of varus plus the amount of carrying angle on the nub. And then you got it completely right. And on all the cases, the carrying angle has been completely restored. So which is a good point. I also saw that in most of the cases, the hyperextension also has been corrected. And I think the K-wire has helped you to correct that hyperextension. So good.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah, okay. Is my screen visible now?
Yeah. Yes, right.
Okay.
Yes,
So
go ahead.
she was a 7-year-old girl. She was playing in the park and had a fall and sustained injury to the right elbow. And this sustained this type of fracture. How do you classify this fracture? Okay, so that fracture,
Intrapnemius, yeah.
yeah. So
Yeah, go ahead.
basically, it's a radial neck fracture, which is completely translated. And I'm not sure about the angulation because I don't know whether to be labeled it as more than 80-degree angulation because it's a completely transected radial neck fracture and completely separated. We can say it's a decapitated one. So how do you manage this? So we can manage. There are three ways to do it: close reduction. But looking at the fracture pattern, when there is absolutely no contact, it looks a bit tough. So we can use assisted close reduction, which I used for this particular case. And if it doesn't work, then we always have the option of open reduction. So there is enough literature available to support this assisted close reduction techniques. So these are intraop images, as you can see. The radial head is completely lying laterally and posteriorly. So what I did, I used a 2 mm K wire, remained close to the ulnar border, and tried to convert and tried to get these fragments first of all in contact with each other. So that's how they came in contact with each other. Then the proximal fragment was flipped back to achieve the reduction. And the same wire was advanced to get the cortical purchase. And this is the intraoperative final picture. stability video, it was completely stable in full pronation and supination, and most important, the nerve which we care about is PIN, and that was intact. So this case was just done yesterday only. In cases where the elbow is poorly ossified, like this, a child which is a 4-year-old, where to appreciate the displacement or angulation of the radial neck is a bit tough. So we can always do an arthrogram, do the reduction, and intra-op you can see the radial head nicely sitting, supported by a K-wire. The K-wire is removed at about 12 days, and this is a 6 weeks post-op with good function, a good X-ray. And when we can't get closed or percutaneous reduction, then we should always go for open reduction. And the cause of poor results in such cases appears to be related to the mainly trauma which has happened at the time of injury. The bones and soft tissues, they take the toll, and that's most important. So in summary, attempt of assisted reduction is worth in such severely displaced fractures. To stay away from PIN, we need to be close to the ulnar border, avoid multiple attempts, acceptability reductions, and the K-wire should be removed early.
Excellent, thank you. So I think we had published this K-wire assisted reduction in Journal of MOE itself about 7, 8 years or 9 years ago.
So
please ask the question.
Yeah. Is this intrafocal K-wire pinning is better, or Matizor technique with a 10 snail, which is a better one? I think seniors cannot.
Rajiv, you want to answer?
Yeah. Basically, I'm more comfortable with these intrafocal pinning methods because we have a very good control on the proximal fragment. With Matizor technique, I'm not having good comfort level in doing that. So I don't prefer that.
So both are completely different. The indications are completely different. The severe displacement like this, the attempt at reduction has to be first with the method which Rajiv has described, which is assisted reduction. Now what Matizio technique would do, the residual 20 to 30 degree of angulation, it will correct with help of an intramedullary bent wire. So Matizio technique is different, but it will not work on its own. Now, advantage of Matizio technique as a fixation, it is not a very great reduction tool. It's a great fixation tool because it gives rotational stability. The wires which Rajiv has passed, no, it is likely that sometimes it will irritate. And many times we reduce with a wire like what Rajiv has shown, but I fix it with Matizio's technique. The advantage is then the elbow is free. The wire is going through lower end of radius. The in Matizio's technique, the modification what I use is I don't use elastic nail. I use a K-wire. And secondly, the tip of the K-wire has to be bent. And the third tip is that the tip of the K-wire has to be very sharp. Only then it can penetrate into the bone of the radial head and hold it well. So Matizio technique is to, you know, just to, you know, and rotate the radial head and get it into a better position.
Yeah, so if I can just add to that, Taral's comments is that I feel that intrafocal is better, not because we published it, because removing the K-wire is simpler. When you do a Matizio or a radial nail, you have a distal incision which is away from the primary injury. And you need a bigger procedure for removing of implant. So whereas this wire is there temporary till glue forms, which is about 10 days, and you just pull it out percutaneously and continue with cast. So it makes it more patient-friendly. That's all.
Sir, when we one
thing I want to add.
Yeah.
In that K-wire, so intrafocal K-wire, when Rajiv reduces it, we have to go from quite distal to proximal, and we have to lever it.
Yeah, you have to lever
and we have to reduce. Then what we can add a straight K-wire so that the soft tissue tension is less, because the tension is very painful later on.
Venugopal, sir?
Yeah, good point.
When you do say, I'll stop close reduction and go for open reduction, what is the criteria of going for an open reduction in such case? Suppose close reduction is not coming. Or you never do an open reduction.
What is your indication, Rajiv?
The indication is if I am not able to get a win into an acceptable alignment, that is
Judas. So type what's acceptable you need to know.
Judas type 1 and 2. Regeneration less than 30 degrees.
Geoffrey's type 2 fracture, what happens is the radiality is dislocated. And when someone has tried to reduce it, the head fractures. Now what happens is now the radial head is placed between the capitulum on one side and the radial neck on one side. And there is no way you can get a closed reduction. Then you need an open reduction. Now in open reduction, if you're going to do, you must keep the periosteal hinge intact. That's the key.
That's very important, yeah.
You keep the periosteal hinge intact, then you maintain your stability and maintain your vascularity. If you, in order to get the reduction, if you break the periosteal hinge, then your vascularity will be lost.
Okay. So I think, Sujit, can you just run through your cases because we are nearing 7 o'clock. We have some time. No problem.
Yeah,
6:34. Yeah.
Sandeep's watch is matched to Bangladesh or Burma watch. Very interesting session. We have excellent cases. And, Ashok has given the good news that we have more than 1,600
people
watching this. So thank you all the viewers for being with us on Sunday evening. Yeah, please.
Good evening, everyone. I thank Maharashtra Orthopedic Association, Dr. Sandeep Patwardhan and other stalwarts for giving me this opportunity. I'll present a couple of cases. The first one is a four-year-old male child with a history of fall on outstretched hand. He went to an orthopedician nearby. He was diagnosed as just a soft tissue injury and he was managed with above elbow cast for 3 weeks. Anyone would like to comment on this x-ray, sir?
Lateral
condyle
injury. I think it is a lateral condyle type 1.
Lateral condyle.
The radial head is.
It looks like Montegia variant type.
Montegia variant. Now the radial head looks subluxated.
Yeah, radial head.
So exactly. So in all these injuries, it's always better to draw this McLaurin's line or radiocapillary line. You can see clearly the McLaurin's line is anterior to the capitulum. It is not bisecting the capitulum. Also, you should be able to draw this Mubarak's line, which is a line drawn from along the dorsal border of ulna from the olecranon to the distal metaphysis. Ideally, this gap should be less than 0.1 mm. But if there is any plastic deformation of ulna with radial head dislocation, this will be around 3 to 4 mm. So all these cases, we should draw this McLaurin's line as well as the Mubarak's line to not to miss these fractures. So this patient has come to us 2 months following the injury. You can see the left side, that is the normal side, where the radiocapillary line is bisecting the capitulum, whereas in the injured side, that is on the right side, it is going anterior to the capitulum. In the same way, if you draw a Mubarak's line, there is less than 0.1 mm gap in the maximum ulnar bow in the left side, whereas in the right side, that is on the injured side, you can see more than 4 mm difference. So how do you like to manage this, sir?
First of all, I want to ask Sandeep, this question, because he has a very good answer for this. Why do you need? So how will come later on? First is why. Why do you need to treat this at all? Because most of these patients will have good range of movement.
Yeah. So the thing is, Kalamchi has given in his paper that there are a couple of reasons why you cannot leave a missed Montegia alone. One is that the radial head, which is cartilaginous, continues to grow and creates a large indentation and a flexion block eventually. Second, there is valgus instability. As the child grows older, the MCL gets overstretched. And that causes valgus instability to the elbow, which cannot be treated effectively as an adolescent or an adult unless you have the head in its position. So irrespective of what is the range of motion, you must get this properly.
Sujit, how would you treat this if you were treating the patient on day one and you diagnosed it correctly? How would you treat that?
Sir, on day one, I would like to concentrate on the radial head reduction, not on the, irrespective of the ulnar deformity, I want the radial head to fall back in place with the, I want the radiocapillary line bisecting the capitulum, center of the capitulum.
Rajiv Nirwane, Sujit did not know what to do and he called you up. how would you advise him?
I cannot go
and operate at his place.
Yeah. I'll ask
social distancing. What will you tell him? What are the tips you will give him to treat this patient well on first day?
Yeah. I'll ask him to get a hyperflexion view, elbow lateral in a completely flexed position. If that maintains the radiocapital alignment, then the hyperflexion will neutralize the biceps pulling force, and we can conserve this in this particular position for about 3 weeks.
What about the ulna? Ulna, you know, he's clearly shown that there is an anterior angulation of ulna. There is a plastic deformation of ulna.
So yeah.
How would you correct that?
So in that scenario, if it requires, then you can attempt a close reduction for this particular fracture.
Absolutely.
I'll
show you the trick here. The trick here is to correct this ulnar angulation with sustained pressure. So what you do here is have two roll towels. And with these two roll towel, you keep the forearm. And then you select the strongest person around to give a pressure over the ulnar bow and sustain pressure for it. It requires sustained pressure for 4 to 5 minutes. And so much so that the person who is giving the pressure will feel fatigued and pain. So you have to give pressure till that time. And then you will see when you see under C-arm, slowly the ulna will unbend itself. And then if you hyperflex the elbow, the radial head will also reduce. So the key is in correcting ulnar angulation. You don't have to fracture ulna. You don't have to osteotomize ulna in an acute situation. You just have to
move it
with a close reduction with sustained pressure. Always aim to overcorrect a little bit, because in plastic deformation, part of the deformation will spring back, you know, once you give a plaster. And it's important, as Rajiv said, to give plaster in hyperflexion, because the ulna will be corrected with plaster. You've already corrected it, but the radial head should be maintained in hyperflexion, because only then the biceps tendon will be loose and it will not dislocate the radial head. How long should we give the plaster, Sandeep, in this situation? How long should we immobilize?
3 to 4 weeks in a younger kid, less than 3 to 4 weeks should be enough.
So not required for 6 weeks. You can mobilize these patients earlier. Now what will you do? You know, I want to ask
Sujit.
Yeah, I think Dr. Desai, this is what has been done. So Samir is here around. Can he? Or Govardhan, you want to comment on this? What has been done? Is that adequate?
This is quite okay. The ulnar lengthening has been done. Probably with ulnar lengthening only, you might have got reduction of the radial head, but it is back in place. Absolutely. Very rarely, if you don't get reduction, then you may have to open.
And if you don't get
entrapment of annular, if there is an entrapment of annular ligament.
So first step is ulnar osteotomy, lengthening and angulation. If that doesn't work, you will open the radial head. And if that doesn't give stability, the last step would be to reconstruct the annular ligament.
Okay.
So do you have follow-up of this patient?
Sujit, you can go ahead.
It is immediate post-op. Okay. This is 1 month following.
So one sort of a, you know, tip, just go back to the last slide. Where to do the ulnar osteotomy? A lot of time people get confused. The initial angulation was at a different place and your osteotomy is at a different place. But this is what I would do. If you do osteotomy at initial angulation, the problem is your plate comes very distally and the force and the angle you have to give to reduce the radial head is much greater. So do the osteotomy as close to the elbow as possible. Now, the only limiting factor is the plate. So, you know, you will generally do it at third or fourth hole of whatever plate you are using. So proximal, the better, because it heals also.
Sujit, just go ahead.
Yes, sir. So there is a 7-year-old child who had a fall on outstretched hand. He presented with pain and swelling over the wrist and forearm. So the X-ray shows distal radius and distal ulna fracture, probably a physeal injury. So as a rule, the treating orthopedic surgeon took X-ray of one joint above, one joint below. So which revealed one more fracture. There is a fracture of the proximal ulna. Anyone would like to comment on this X-ray, sir?
Again, you must draw the lines.
Yes, sir. Exactly.
Go ahead, because we are short of time.
The line, radiocapital line, is missing off. Yes.
So
in this case, the treating orthopedic surgeon managed it with close reduction and cast. he has well reduced the distal radius. He has concentrated on the ulna fracture, which was well reduced, but probably it was the montagia was missed here.
Mister.
So the radial McLaurin's line is passing anterior to the capitulum here. You can see this is like Bado type 1 or let's type C fracture, where you can see positive ulnar bursae. So the patient presented to us 3 months following the injury. This is how he was presented, with a block in terminal flexion. There is some palpable bony thing in the elbow with restriction of terminal supronation. How do you like to manage this?
Same way, go ahead.
Same. So it was managed with dorsal open wedge osteotomy and fixed with a plate. So this is 1 month following the fixation.
Sujit, I like this plate much better than the previous one because okay. This is closer to the metaphyse.
Okay.
Yeah.
Is it, this is it because it is more stronger or?
No. It is closer to the elbow joint. Closer to the
elbow. Okay. Do you
prefer? It's about the osteotomy level, not a plate.
Okay.
Yeah. So the what happens is that osteotomy ideally should be as close to the cora as possible, but you must at least get 2 screws in proximal fragment. So that is a restricting factor for stability. So typically, as Taral said, third hole, and then your upper screw has to be half, otherwise you'll go into the elbow joint.
The first screw is having only unicortical purchase. Do you accept that?
Yes, it's a metaphyseal screw, so we use a capsule screw, and also we cast it. So it's not that
easy. Immobilized.
As you can see, the radiocapillary line is well aligned in the post-operative X-ray as well as in the follow-up thing. This is after the implant as well. He has got full range of points.
Only thing, how would you manage again on day one, Sujit, this limb fracture?
Sir, day one, probably if he has presented to me in this condition, I would have reduced the distal radius and ulna well. And concentrate more on the montagia reduction rather than on the ulna reduction. I would have, ignore this.
To radial head,
to more of apex dorsal side. I would have angulated ulna little more so that the radial head falls back.
So key to radial reduction is to maintain ulnar length. Always the key to radial head reduction is not in radius. It is in ulna. You have to maintain the ulna length. This is a short oblique fracture, and only way to maintain the ulna length and prevent a redislocation is to nail it. So this is the patient where you would do a close K-wire fixation.
Yeah,
or
intramedullary nail.
Okay. This is the literature, review of literature. There is an article by Mubarak and Lincoln where he says the uninjured side, it is maximum ulnar bow is more less than 0.1 mm, whereas on the injured side, it is 4 mm, and the location of maximal ulnar bow, he says it is at a mean distance of 45% of the ulnar length. And he also states that isolated radial head dislocation probably does not exist. It is always associated with minimal plastic deformation of the ulna. There is one more article stating the same importance of both the lines. So my message to the young orthopedic surgeons is always have a high index of suspicion in these injuries. Always draw these two lines so not to miss a montagia fracture. And if you see a radial head dislocation, always look for plastic deformation of ulna. Also, if there is ulna fracture, always look for radial head subluxation or dislocation. Thank you.
Thank you. So I think that was. Any questions on that, or I will just share my screen because I think we will finish with the last talk.
केस माझी पण एक होती पण ठीक आहे
अच्छा हां नाही नाही अरे सॉरी 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 तुझी केस दाखवा अजून मला वाटलं गो अहेड विथ योर केस
या या आई विल लाइक टू शो माय स्क्रीन या एम आई ऑडिबल नाउ Yeah, yes. I had one boy who came to me at 9 years of old with 5 year old injury to the left elbow. So this is how he has been presented. Untreated injury. So he has a cubitus valgus with prominent medial epicondyle,
disturb range of motions, as well as he has a good range of movement. So any juniors who they want any other information other than this X-ray and this clinical
test. Does he have any Andhra symptoms?
Yeah, yeah, he has. You know, that's what I just wanted someone to laugh.
Okay.
Yeah, juniors to ask. Okay, so he had this hypothenar vesting along with flexion attitude of ring and little finger.
So I just
and
wanted
the thinner sign was positive clinical. So
more than I want to just make one point. Yes, if you can. So the point I want to make is if you have tardy ulnar nerve palsy so early, you know, generally it develops after 10, 12 years age. But if it's come so early, it means there is instability of the elbow, mediolateral. And there are papers which have seen that why do you get ulnar neuritis? It's not because of pressure or tenting. It's because the ulnar nerve is moving mediolaterally.
Instability.
Because lateral condyle is important stabilizer of the elbow joint. So here it's important even more, you know, that of course you need to correct the deformity. You need to treat the ulnar nerve, but also treat the instability by fixing that fragment at the same time. Yeah.
So now he is 9 years old when he came to me, and almost 5 years back in England, that was the time, you know, around 4 to 5 years old. And there was a progressive deformity, obviously, and this is the clinical presentation with non-union. So now we have a problem with this. This one is non-union and other is tardy ulnar nerve palsy. So the treatment option which are with us are either to achieve union, or you can go for deformity correction with or without union, or we can do ulnar nerve transposition, or we can do combination of this. So anybody wants to like.
So Govardhan, his predominant problem was non-union pain and a progressive deformity causing the tardy ulnar nerve palsy. So you have to address all three.
Okay.
Yeah, so but the key would be probably you don't dissect too much into the joint so that you don't create a stiffness. Fix that. So fix in C2, so, do a varus osteotomy and transpose the ulnar.
So fixation pre-op
only parents needs to be counseled that the elbow range may decrease post fixation, post stabilization.
Okay. So this for union, it is in situ fixation or you may go for open reduction. But problem of stiffness and AVN always are persistent with it. Sometimes, many times we have to plan for deformity correction and osteotomy. As sir has said already, that we can go for everything at the same sitting because it may land, if the joint is painful, instability and valgus is more than 30 degrees almost. So this can be done, such kind of corrective osteotomy and fixation of both getting union and correction of deformity as well as. But as Taral Sagar has pointed out, now if you see this is the range of movement the guy had, and this is kind of a, so probably that time I was quite okay with just to do ulnar nerve transposition. So I did enter ulnar nerve transposition, which has led to recovery of ulnar nerve almost in 2.5 to 3 months. He has complete recovery of this tardy ulnar nerve. And as the joint movement was good, the stability was good, I opted to just rest on the transport.
Absolutely. So it's always the patient's demand, Govardhan. It's not that everything needs to be done every time. What is the basic problem that it is bothering him? Is it the palsy? Is it the pain? Is it the deformity? And then address it accordingly.
Yeah. Absolutely. Only thing is that along with this.
No, no. So that's fine. Absolutely. As you say, it is need-based treatment.
Yeah.
So what does he want? You know, whatever the patient wants, but this will give rise to instability. See, if you go back to one X-ray, I'm just taking 2 minutes of time, but this X-ray,
this
is Milch type 2, you know, you see fracture line is going beyond the trochlea, and here restoration of mechanical axis and stability is also important. So you would at least counsel that all should be done. You've treated one part of the story. The other two parts still remain behind. And if he comes back with symptoms, you'll be ready to treat it.
He's around 10 to 10 and a half years now. So I have to keep a follow-up because probably I feel when he lands in growth spurt, the deformity may progress that time, and we may have to go ahead and fix, do the correct option.
Okay.
Yeah, and only the point of this bigger incision is, you can see the big incision on the left side. That is to release this completely. So, you know, the arcade of scooter has to be released, this aponeurotic band has to be released before anterior transposition of the nerve. Otherwise, it will get tethered.
Yes.
Upwards. Yeah. So, you need a little bigger incision.
So technically, you know, we have done, me and Sandeep, we have done some of these cases at Ganga Hospital together, and both of us prefer the medial approach, because through medial approach, you can address the ulnar nerve, you can do the osteotomy, translate it, and then you take a very small incision and the plate is on the medial side, and the on the lateral side, we take a very small incision and fix a screw to cause osteosynthesis of the fragment. So, you know, through the same incision, you could have done the osteotomy also.
Sir, my one question is like, when it, you should, we will pre, should prefer to do in situ fixation.
In situ fixation is done. Yeah,
when, in situ fixation.
Yeah. So if a child comes after a non-union lateral condyle, after very early, after 5-6 months, the deformity has still not happened, ulnar neuritis has not happened. It's just a non-union. So that's the time you can just do fixation in situ with a screw, and it will still heal. You don't have to open the fracture.
With fragments in good position and no deformity.
Absolutely.
Okay.
Not a rotated fragment. Yeah.
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Is it just anterior position of ulnar nerve is sufficient, or you do a neurolysis? Is it necessary? Or just anterior transposition of ulnar nerve in such cases?
So neurolysis is routinely not required, because it's not entrapped in the fracture, or it is not fibrous that much.
I think only anterior transposition is sufficient. There is no need of neurolysis.
I think when he is doing the anterior transposition, as he rightly pointed out, the septum from where it comes out has to be released. So it is mobilized easily. That itself is good neurolysis.
Okay. Once we had to do this in a 42-year-old lady, and there we had to do neurolysis because the ulnar nerve was actually very thin.
Thinned out, correct. Of
fibrosis. So fibrosis does occur. And neuritis and fibrosis, because of instability, is the reason for ulnar nerve to get involved. Yeah.
Okay. Correct.
Nice.
So,
okay. I think cases are over. Yeah.
So,
come to the last presentation, which should not be thrown in the kachre ka dabba, should not be thrown in trash. People should preserve this message, which is going to talk about.
Govardhan needs to unshare his screen.
Govardhan, please stop sharing your screen so that Sandeep can come alive. On the last lecture of this very lively Maharashtra Orthopedic Association.
Oh, yes. Yes, sir. Okay.
Master series.
Can you see?
Trash lesions.
We can.
Yeah.
Yes, Sandeep.
Okay, sorry. So I'll go through this very quickly. I know we have made this supracondylar, lateral condyle, and other stories. So this is the last little bit, the other stories of the elbow. Okay, and you need not be Mantrik the magician to find out what's happening in the elbow if you know what injuries exist. It's always an enigma. The child had a fall on his hand, elbow is swollen and painful, and you get an X-ray done. In your mind, there are only two fractures. 75% of the times it's supracondylar, 17% of the times it's lateral condyle, which is very well covered by Premal and Taral in their talks. So that makes it about 93%. But what about the remaining 7-8%? And if your eyes don't know, eyes won't see what the mind doesn't know. So you should know what are the other lesions which are called trash lesions. What are trash lesions? Trash is, you see a swollen elbow, you take an X-ray and it looks innocuous. You see nothing on it, like the missed Montagia, and you throw it in kachre ka dabba. Okay, like throwing it away in a trash bin. So a trash lesion is an osteochondral fracture which is not seen or poorly seen on an X-ray and is dismissed as elbow sprain or elbow soft tissue injury, which we saw earlier. We'll run through a few examples. A 9-year-old boy, you can see a painful swollen elbow. This X-ray was done, and somebody who treated him initially thought nothing is wrong and sent him away. Now, this boy was a state level boxer. He was about 9 years old, undergoing training for boxing. And he came to me with a flexion deformity, painful stiff elbow. And when we drew the line, McLaughlin's line, we found that the radial head had subluxated posterior. Right? So if you see very closely, there is an anterior small fragment here, which you can see. And a CT scan confirmed a radial head fracture with a posterior subluxation of the remaining shaft through the head. So this is what happens. This is one of the commonest trash lesions that you see. And this was already 3 months old. So we weren't very sure whether we'll be able to restore all his function. But there was no option but to do operative treatment for him. So we opened the radial head osteochondral fracture. I had to trim a little bit of cartilage because in an attempt to heal, the cartilage had overgrown. And then I fixed it with a Herbert screw, as you can see here. And that's the video showing you the rotation after the radial shaft with part of the head has been restored. And I had to trim a little bit of the head. And that is how it went. That was the open reduction and fixation. And this was his image. He went on to a good healing. And that's Tarang. Tarang was with me at that time. And this fellow has gone back to boxing. And you can see he's got full range of motion and he's got a very good stable elbow. So a radial head osteochondral fracture with posterior subluxation of the shaft is a very important trash lesion that you should be aware of, right? Now, a second case, a three-year-old with a swollen elbow with restricted supination. Now, in this particular X-ray, you don't see anything on the radial side except for some irregularity. And when an MRI was done, what was found was the entire radial head, which was cartilaginous, was lying outside. So what Rajiv showed was a metaphyseal fracture. Now, you must remember that the radial head ossifies at 5 years of age. You start seeing the bone formation in the head around 4 or 5 years. So a younger child with a radial side injury with a large swelling, don't ignore it because X-ray doesn't show anything. Here, the entire cartilaginous radial head is lying outside and that needed to be reposed in its original position. So radial neck fracture with a dislocated radial head, exactly the same injury, but no ossification in the head. The next injury is a 5-year-old where you see a small flake of bone like this on the medial side. Now this again, people mistake it for a medial epicondylar fracture. If you look at the normal side, this is where the medial epicondyle is. And if you look on the injured side, this is a large chunk of bone. It's not so small as normal. So this was treated conservatively thinking it's a medial epicondylar injury, which can be conserved. 3 months later, he was no better. And as time went by, you see the fragment size has actually increased. Now, no fragment can increase in size unless there is re-ossification or callus formation. So what was happening is that there was metaphyseal ossification in the attempt to heal and the true diagnosis was medial condylar fracture. Right? So medial epicondyle fracture does not happen less than 8 years of age. Usually medial epicondyle happens with elbow dislocation or isolated injury has already been discussed by a case which Samir showed. So it's an avulsion fracture, but smaller children with a medial sided bone fragment, think of medial condyle injury and not a medial epicondyle. So this was his ultimate position, a bad stiff elbow with rubitus varus because of a missed medial condylar fracture and with very poor function. So this is another example of a 4-year-old child. You see a large soft tissue swelling on the medial side. And if you look very closely, there's a small dot here. Okay. And when you do an arthrogram, which is an important investigation, you see that this is a large chunk of bone. So like the lateral condyle, which Taral so beautifully showed us, can displace, the whole medial condyle can come out like that. And that was a medial condylar injury, which is intra-articular, needs open reduction and fixation. Another 5-year-old child, a large, you can see this huge medial swelling here, large swelling here and a small little crescent of bone there. And what happens on MRI, you see the whole medial condyle lying outside. Beautifully demonstrated, the MRI showing cartilage here and the entire medial condyle lying outside. So this is one of the trash lesions where X-ray may be seemingly innocuous, but the elbow is largely swollen. So the key point to remember is medial epicondylar fracture before the age of 9 is a medial condylar fracture unless proven otherwise. The next case, everybody is now familiar with this, something that is transfacial separation, posteromedial movement of the radius and ulna, the distal fragment moves laterally. Sometimes you get it with a metafacial small piece, or you get it without a metafacial piece. But you have to treat it like a supracondylar fracture. You will find that the radius and ulna are congruent and attached to the distal fragment. So you do an arthrogram, you reduce it, and you pin it like a supracondylar fracture. So this is another one of the trash lesions. One more X-ray, a swollen elbow, a lateral and an AP view. Looks innocuous, looks as if nothing is happening. But if you look very closely after some time, this is displaced and gone into a cubitus varus. Now, if you revisit the earlier X-ray, you see that there was a hairline fracture going all the way across, which was missed, and a large soft tissue swelling. And it eventually drifted into a varus position, so a Monteggia variant, causing a bad injury, bad outcome. Medial epicondyle has been discussed, an avulsion fracture with instability. You can see the medial opening here, the dye pooling with an arthrogram, and open reduction and fixation with a cancellous screw with a restoration of function, especially in high demand children. Another example where, now this case again, I won't go into detail, you can see this trapped medial epicondylar fragment. That piece lying there, this case has been discussed earlier. So you have an elbow dislocation in an adolescent, 9 years and above. You reduce it, either the epicondyle sits back or it gets entrapped. You must be aware that it can get entrapped and be ready to open and bring it out along with the ulnar nerve. So incarcerated or trapped fragment, you might excise, do arthrolysis, it comes late. Now you can see this ulnar nerve here trapped inside the joint. You can see the joint inside and the ulnar nerve inside with the fragment. So that had to be removed, and then the fragment was brought out and then fixed where it belonged. So be aware that that is important. Lateral condyle, again, I'm not going to discuss. Tharal has beautifully told you. And we won't talk about all this because we don't have time. Right. So sleeve fractures. So this is another important. An adolescent child who had a sleeve shear fracture or a capitular fracture. So this was treated with a slab by an arthroplasty surgeon. Look at the quality of X-rays here, AP and lateral. And he was told that you have nothing. This was trashed. Elbow was trashed. A slab was given. He was sent home on this X-ray. And he came to us 3 months later with a stiff, painful elbow. And when you look at a dead lateral, you see that there is a shear fracture of the capitula. So capitular fractures in adolescent age group are very common. You need additional investigations, and you need open reduction, and then fixation with Herbert screws to
this. Sir, sorry to interrupt. Your sound is not clear.
Yeah, just okay. I'm just, can you hear me now?
Yeah, we can.
Okay, so let me just summarize. Trash lesions are a group of osteochondral injuries, which if treated insufficiently are going to cause long-term consequences. All of them are displaced. All of them are unstable. All of them require surgery. The important part is high index of suspicion and additional imaging each and every time. Ultrasound, if you are able to do it, but it is operator dependent, your radiologist must be able to delineate the fragments. An MRI is more suitable and accurate, but it requires sedation or anesthesia and can be expensive. Arthrograms, there is a small learning curve which you can get over, but it's dynamic and functional. So a swollen elbow in a small child with a cartilaginous elbow, don't trash the X-ray, suspect all these injuries, get additional investigations as required. Supracondylar and lateral condyle are not the only fractures around the elbow. Be ready for surgical intervention most of the times. Let me summarize these lesions for you, or you can go and read Peter Waters' paper from JPO 2010. Osteochondral fractures of the radial head, which I showed, with incongruity, Monteggia fractured dislocations, lateral condyle capitular shear fractures, unossified medial condyle humerus fractures, transfacial separations, entrapped medial epicondylar fractures, and complex osteochondral fracture dislocations in younger children. Always remember the ossification pattern around the elbow so that you know at which age which part of the cartilage is seen on a plain X-ray. If you know this, you won't make a mistake of thing and a trash lesion. So knowledge is power, and I'll leave you with that message. Thank you very much.
Sandeep, with permission from Dr. Shinde and you, can I just share about the forthcoming IFIX meeting?
Yes.
The faculties. So, yeah, just in, I'll take 1 minute of the audience to introduce them to what is coming up as a Indian meeting on fractures in children with help of Ortho TV and Vama events. And we are having a meeting completely on the net. So you don't have to go, you don't have to go on site. You can do this from your home. And this is going to be Saturdays and Sundays in September. A session like this, you will have 8 sessions, and these are the 18 international faculties who are topmost in the fracture which we are discussing. They will be with us. Dr. Teddy Slongo will have the oration on 37 years of experience with elastic nails in children. And all this will be available to you just for rupees 2000 and just 1000 rupees for postgraduate students. So you can register online by visiting our website, ifix.in. This link also will be present at Ortho TV website. And I wish that all those who are attending this webinar and the members of Maharashtra Orthopedic Association would attend this, because in every 2 hour session, 1 hour is going to be case discussion and 1 hour is going to be lectures. And in addition, there are going to be
a lot video of techniques.
Lectures and material available.
So I think we'll conclude the elbow fracture session today, and I thank Dr. Shinde and MOA for giving us this opportunity.
Yeah. Any questions from anybody here? Anything else? Dr. Shinde, Dr. Samaram, Govardhan, yeah, any queries? Yeah, let's not go back with questions which are unanswered. So let's answer all of them.
Yeah, unmute, sir.
Please unmute. Dr. Samaram, please unmute yourself and ask the question.
In a case of old Montager fracture dislocation, when would you like to go first with open reduction of radial head? Or would you always do a ulnar osteotomy first, try for a reduction of the radial head dislocation? Or what would be the sequence? And when would you like to go first for the radial head open reduction?
But the sequence is always ulnar osteotomy first, but it also depends on duration. If you are dealing with a younger child with a duration less than 6 months, you do the osteotomy and there's a good chance that it might come back in. It's not mandatory that it will, because there may be capsular fragments which are interposed or the annular ligament which is not allowing you a reduction unless you cut it. But you start with the ulnar osteotomy.
Okay.
Second step will be radial head, and third is annular ligament reconstruction.
So Dr. Samaram, I had given the same answer sometime back.
Yeah,
and after a month, I had a case which had posterior interosseous nerve palsy along with Montagian with ulnar deformity. And in that case, we opened the radial head first, isolated the nerve. Then we went on to ulnar and reduced the radial head. Because in that case, if we had done the ulnar osteotomy and tried to do a close reduction of radial head, that nerve would have been closed.
So it's situational, and if it is 6 months and above, then I think you have to open the radial head. So I take my incision going right up and start from above below.
But sometime okay. I found in two late cases the head is deformed.
Deformed, yes.
And it is very difficult to reduce. Even if you do the ptosis process, it can't maintain.
Yes, so that is what we were discussing, sir. The papers which have been published all say that less than 3 years dislocation, Montagian,
yes,
and an age group of less than 9 years are suitable for reconstruction. Older children, the results may not be as good, but even so, what I have found is adolescent and adults, I have seen few who have come with untreated Montagias. They are miserable with valgus instability and anterior flexion block. So you can warn the parents that you will lose pronosupination, but you still must do the reduction and do the distraction osteotomy of the ulnar.
So I'll give you a trick.
Tell them you're going to lose the pronosupination because the head is deformed.
Dr. Shinde, I'll give you one trick in those cases. You know, one girl I had operated at Rajkot, she was 18 years old. And she came because now, you know, she obviously had to get married. That's a stupid excuse for getting a surgery done. But in that case, what we did, you overlengthen the ulna, put a block graft. So when you do overlengthen the ulna, the contact between radial head and capitulum becomes less. It becomes like a hanging radial head. And in that case, even a deformed radial head will not give a problem. So we'll have to modify the procedure a little bit.
Okay.
So anytime, whether anybody has needed to excise a little bit of radial head.
Yeah. Like I said, overgrown part, you always trim it circumference.
Trim it, yeah.
Try to, so try to make it fitting as much as possible.
As round as possible.
Yeah, I want to ask Taral whether you did at that time ulnar osteotomy and then the only lengthening of ulnar radial head has been reduced?
No, no. So we did ulnar osteotomy. Then I opened the radial head. When I opened the radial head, I saw that it was concave. It was convex and it was really large. I mean, not very large, but it was something which was dysplastic radial head. So what we did is we put a distractor intraop, overlengthened ulna, and then the radial head was more stable. Then I did articular ligament, annular ligament reconstruction, but the ulnar gap was so much that I had to put a graft and plate to hold it. So over distraction of ulna has been described.
With dysplastic. Yeah, you can transfix the radial head temporarily. Till your ulnar fixation is completed and then pull that pin out. We don't leave it in.
Venkat sir and this Rashikran sir had shown that Z lengthening of the ulna.
Yeah, everybody has his own technique.
Their own technique, yeah.
So we tried it, but it does not allow you know, the problem is it become very thin and they just fix it with one interfragment.
Yeah,
that is too flimsy. So it's better to plate. And in children, if you leave a gap, you don't even have to graft it. It is going to heal on its own.
Right. Okay.
So I think if all questions are exhausted, I think let's call it an evening. Fractures. And
everything is over, then I like to speak.
Yes.
Absolutely, sir.
It was a great experience, Dr. Sandeep. Dr. Taral and senior moderators did their job very nicely. Presenter given a good input. Thanks everyone. Special thanks to Shyam Ashok for his cooperation and contribution. Thank you very much.
We'll meet next Sunday with the hip session, right?
Hi, next Sunday we at the same time, we have already declared the topic hip.
Yes. Okay, sir. Good night.
Good night. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, sir.